And as for some of our folks, the year is winding down and they're getting to take a break. We also have many in our district whose life is spooling up, and this will be the busiest season of the year for them. That includes our finance office, who will be finishing off our budget year and launching the next budget year right in the middle of the summer. And all of our facilities, maintenance, and grounds folks who will be already starting at getting our facilities ready for next school year and frantically trying to make sure they get all of those projects done in time for an August 1st start. So I hope everyone who's starting their break is using it to get rejuvenated, and I hope you enjoy it. It's very well deserved. And for those of you who are heading into your hardest part of the year, thank you for tooling through as you're watching some of us really be able to take our time off. We appreciate you continuing to push it through and getting us all ready for August. And for that, also just a reminder to everyone to fill out their evaluation forms and return them to Donna. And the board every month gets an informational item to help us with our professional development. And this month it's an article from CASB on the legal requirements for executive sessions. And now our chief officer update.
Yeah, it's been kind of fun. I jump on board with John. It was kind of fun to really watch the graduation the year before. I actually missed it because of a medical issue, and it was kind of, I enjoyed that just as really to see the students as they graduate, really just the different reactions of how they react to the environment. It's kind of neat to see some of them really have a glazed look on it. Some of them have a jovial look on them, and then some of them really feel, you tell they really get confident about what they're going to be doing in their future. And to be able to see the teachers, because it's really what we're about. We're about education. And one of the things that we're having a session today a little bit with Lyle Wells is with our group is really how do we support the instructional process. And so one of the ways we're beginning to support it is we have quite a few projects that we'll be doing over the summer that are really pulling the midnight oil, and we're pulling air out trying to get all of them done, but we're going to manage to get them all done by August 2nd.
So yes, thank you for mentioning that the end of the school year is followed really quickly by the end of the fiscal year. And we already had auditors in actually this week doing that work. So it is a busy time of year in business as well as operations. One of the fun things that I'm gonna get to do this summer is speak at the Future of Education Finance Summit in Baltimore, Maryland next month. I was asked to do that just last month here. So we look forward to representing us and our processes and our ideas and our innovations there at a national level.
Brett couldn't get me a ticket to that session. I wanted to say two things to the board. One, thank you for your presence. Our teachers notice it, our students notice it. I had so many people say to me how much they appreciated Maria, you coming to the end of your literacy update that we got. That just doesn't happen. And in our work with Rocky Mountain Performance Excellence, the fact that you've all been to multiple Performance Excellence events is just, it doesn't happen nationally to have a board that is that engaged. So I wanted to say thank you to you all. And since I will not be here at the work session when the primary literacy results are presented formally, I just wanted to look you all in the eye and thank you for the gift of focus, because 2 years ago you said, take this on to the entire district, to our operations team, finance team, and education team. You said, take this on, make this a priority. And so when you hear good news that you're gonna hear in a couple of weeks, I just wanted to remind you that it started at that table and it rolled out to the whole district. So I will leave the details for a couple of weeks. You'll be happy when you hear them. But thank you for the push, the shove, and the exhortation to start to turn that trajectory. We've started. We're nowhere near finished, but we appreciated the focus.
That presentation will include some of those statements I heard about national trends versus us, correct? So that we get some of those out there. Just, seeing as you won't be here for me to egg you on, Ben, make sure those are in there.
Okay.
I got to hear it all already, and it's pretty awesome. So I want that awesomeness to be emphasized too. I know we have work to do too, but there were some pretty cool things in there. Okay, and so with that, we'll move on to item 6.0, open forum. And I think we probably do have people signed up. We appreciate and welcome comments on school operations and programs in District 49 as part of tonight's open forum. Please speak directly into the microphone and state your name before beginning. We ask that your comments be made in a respectful and orderly manner. Personal complaints against any individual connected with the school system are prohibited. Follow-up action items may be assigned to the appropriate chief officer depending on the nature of the comments. In accordance with board policy BEDH, public participation is limited to 3 minutes per person. Thank you for participating in our open forum. It is the practice of the board to withhold any board comment or direction to the chiefs until after all who have signed up for open forum have had a chance to speak. I would also like to make you aware of our stakeholder grievance process. This process can be initiated by anyone in our D49 community and guides the community member through the correct people to help resolve their concern, including as a final step, the opportunity to formally appeal to the board. We encourage you to utilize this process as many have successfully resolved their concerns this way. And with that, our first speaker is Mary. I think I'm going to slaughter your last name, Gaucher. Oh, over here. Sorry.
State your name and speak into the mic, please.
My name is Mary Gaucher, and I am the founder and CEO of a nonprofit organization called Life Without Vision, Get the Vision. And our logo is, where there is no vision, people miss the mark. So with that being said, District 49 had a few of students that was a part of a focus group that I had. It was a curriculum that I designed for, and the name of the workshop is called the Goals Educational Workshop for Youth, which is to service middle school students as well as high school students. And so what we're looking to do is to develop these curriculums for middle school students and high school students and eventually evolve to adults. And so on April the 30th of 2016, we had a focus group of approximately 15 students that represented 7 school districts. So those school districts were District 2, District 3, District 8, District 11, District 20, District 49, and District 60. So I was, in fact, I believe 2 of your principals are here that was there to help present that award to those particular students. So I do have a website that is up that kind of features some of these students on their receiving their awards. We had Christian House of Prayer, which is called CHOP here in Colorado Springs, with the 2 pastors, Charles Tedder and Allison Tedder. And we also had the food for lunch donated as an in-kind from Chick-fil-A at the Citadel Mall. So what we're looking to do is to take these workshops and implement them globally. And so, but before the publication and implementation of all of these workshops, each one of the workshops will have a focus group. So starting off with the youth, so if it's a workshop for youth, we'll always have a focus group for the youth. If it's a workshop for the adults, we will always have a focus group utilizing the adults. So one of the things that I'm getting ready to do or work on is a workshop for the adults. And we're also going to do another one for the youth for math. And so I've already gotten some great volunteers that are from the CTAP. Am I saying that right? Some experts that are in the math department that have already said as subject matter experts, they would be willing to assist in that. So I look forward to working with you all. Let me just say this. One of the principals suggested that District 49 be the pilot to run this. So to start it out. So you guys are innovators. So thank you. That's my time.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Rhett Rotwald. I know you'll say it for us in the microphone and then we'll have it right for the record.
Hi, I'm Rhett Rotwald. I'm speaking specifically in relation to action item 7.05, on Rocky Mountain Classical Academy High School homeschool program. D49 has got a number of charter schools, and while I know that they're not the majority of students, they serve a an important niche in our community. They're more innovative and individualized. They tend to serve students that are outside the traditional school model, and particularly some of the at-risk and non-traditional students. Unfortunately, a lot of those students that attend the last statistic I could find was 2014, was that only 40% of the charter school students in D49 actually attended a D49 high school. I found a quote from Tammy on the web that said that we definitely need a charter high school in our D49, and that may be a little dated. We're starting to get some offerings there, but the Rocky Mountain Classical Academy high school program, homeschool high school program, started last year, and there have been some legal attempts and other issues where they have been trying to threaten them and shut them down. It appears to be motivated primarily by possibly either the teachers' unions or somebody behind them that dislikes the fact that they're using teachers that are doctorates or other experts in their field but are not certified teachers. The threats that were made were quickly rescinded after they were set straight, but I think this issue is instead an attempt to rework their charter in such a way as to try and backdoor those types of threats in. I would urge the board to take a close look at this before they decide that the charter needs to be messed with. It seems to me that there's some subversive elements there that want to tweak that for no particularly good reason. It has worked well thus far. It's just fledgling. The high school homeschool program just started last year. It's expanding significantly this year. I think it serves a important need in our community. Thank you.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Ellie Patterson.
Hello, my name is Ellie Patterson. And next year I will be a sophomore in high school. I am the newly elected president of the Rocky Mountain Classical Academy High School student body. I have attended Rocky Mountain Classical Academy homeschool program since I was in second grade. Over the years, I've been really privileged to see the Rocky Mountain Classical Academy homeschool program really grow and evolve. And there are innumerable qualities that make this program exemplary. Today, I would like to highlight three of my favorite aspects about this program. First, the teachers are invested. All the teachers that I've been privileged to learn under are passionate about the subject that they teach. Moreover, all of these passionate teachers have been willing to spend as much time as needed on a lesson in order to ensure complete understanding by the students. Secondly, I really appreciate the small class sizes. The small class allows more potential for learning. It allows flexibility by the teacher to personalize lessons to any students with academic or social abilities or disabilities, as well as allowing for deeper class discussions and for more personal relationships to be formed between students. And finally, the Rocky Mountain Classical Academy homeschool program has always been a key stepping stone in my academic success. Through the teachers, the curriculum, the class discussions, the class sizes, and as well as the relationships that I've made with the students and the teachers, I personally feel that I've had a quality education from both the RMCA high school program and from the instruction of my parents. Thank you for the opportunity for me to come and speak to you guys, and on behalf of the Rocky Mountain Classical Academy High School student body, I would ask you to please not take away this exemplary program from us. We really appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Ellen Duckers.
I am Ellen Duckers, grandparent of the district, been coming here for 28 years to every school board meeting, unless I'm sick or on vacation. I agree with keeping the Classical Academy school open for the homeschooling. I think kids need to have options other than just having to go to public school, whether it's charter school or homeschooling. I think any option is good. So last board meeting, I brought up that my grandson got in trouble in middle school. And he was told by the principal, this is not a democracy, this is a dictatorship, and he doesn't have the freedom of speech. So guess what he's gonna do now? He's gonna write Donald Trump about his experience, which will be good learning experience for him, whether he answers or not, you know, to see what politics is all about. And he loves history, and he got an award in history, so you know, it'll be a good learning experience. And another thing that I experienced, I went to Taco Bell with my husband. The bill came to $10.38, and I only had a $20 bill. This girl could not give me change back. And I'm getting real frustrated with this when I go to places. I mean, this is not the first time this happened. So I finally asked her, I said, what high school did you graduate from? She goes, I'm still in high school, and I graduated from Vista. I'm going to Vista Ridge High School. And I'm like, oh shit, one of our schools. I know we have better teachers than them.
Okay. Neva Harold.
My name is Neva Harold. To summarize from 2 months ago when I exceeded the time limit, Common Core was created by Achieve Inc., which is a conglomerate of businesses such as Microsoft and Pearson Publishing. It's business-led, not state-led. It was never tested or vetted. The April 3rd Gazette article I referenced stated that parents were concerned about privacy of student data and federal testing. The development of the State Longitudinal Data System, which is the SLDS, was the first hurdle the states had to jump over as directed by Race to the Top grant application. Excuse me. The changing of the HIPAA rules in 2009 allowed data sharing with invested parties, plus the federal government funding of the assessments gives it a stakeholder rights to the data provided by the assessments, which are stored in the SLDS. From pre-K through high school, college, and into the workforce, Americans will have every bit of their lives recorded and stored. The new law, HB 1614-23, which just passed, prohibits student data information or student data gathering except as authorized in state or federal law. SLDS and HIPAA do authorize this sharing. A newer article on April 30th was written by a couple of members from the Fordham Institute, which is a supporter of Common Core, and they were urging parents to opt in to the PARC testing due to the new, more rigorous academic standards and the more rigorous tests. The problem with the emphasis on rigor is that children develop at different levels and stages. The challenge is creating an educational system where our kids are being dealt with at their level and given a chance to rise. The fact is we do need educational reform in America, but not that provided by Common Core. We need an educational system that doesn't just see the growth of gifted and special needs children as statistical outliers, but sees an opportunity to cultivate the talents and humanity of these individuals. The education of Colorado's and this nation's children should not be dictated solely and completely by for-profit organizations who mine personal data. Lastly, and this is a quote, a direct quote from June 20th, 2010 press release by Achieve Inc. Full implementation of Common Core means aligning graduation requirements curriculum materials and instruction tools, educator preparation and professional development, assessments, accountability indicators, and data systems with the Common Core State Standards Initiative. So the whole system down to every classroom is geared toward the same end goal. To me, that means they're one size fits all, rigorous standards. So, lastly, Bill Gates now blames the problem with Common Core acceptance on teachers and vows to fight on. I vow to fight on too against it.
Our next speaker is Heather Miller.
My name is Heather Miller. Good evening. I am here as a former classroom teacher. I am currently a homeschool mom, and I actually also work for Rocky Mountain Classical Academy homeschool program. I'm the director's assistant. I'm actually, my primary purpose this evening is just gratitude for the program and for all those who are involved in it. My oldest will be an eighth grader this year. And she also began the program when she was in second grade. I also will have a third grader this next year. And I am so grateful for the quality of the program. From little things to, you know, we don't really get up a rousing volleyball game with just the three of us at home. So that's nice for them. It's also nice to have the teachers, you know, tell my girls, no, your mother did not make up the rule that every sentence begins with a capital letter. So those things are nice to have reinforced at the homeschool program. I am so grateful for the staff. They really do have a focus of quality. I wouldn't bring my kids there if it wasn't. They would never do anything that wasn't a quality program. I'm very grateful for their dedication, the work, the hours they pour into the program. I'm so grateful for Carla Whitmer, the director, who definitely would not settle for low quality in our program. I get a firsthand view being her assistant of the hours and hours and hours she pours into our program and the rest of the staff. And I also am grateful for Christiana Fogler and our board. We have several parents here, and I saw several board members here to support our program, and they are a great support for us. And I also want to thank you, D49, for your support of charter schools in general, but our program in particular, and your focus and support on students. Like I said, my oldest will be an eighth grader this year, and so that high school program will affect her the following year. And so I really appreciate your consideration of continuation of that. And I want her to follow in Ellie's footsteps and be the head of that student council. And so just thank you for your consideration of that.
Thank you. Our final speaker is Lori Chenoweth.
Hello, I'm Lori Chenoweth, and first of all, I'm a homeschool mom. I've been doing homeschooling for 11 years, and so bring a lot of that homeschooling experience to the table. But years ago in the early 90s, I taught in the school districts, all of them in Colorado Springs. And I was one of those teachers who was trained and was proud of my job of teaching and loved children and wanted to bring a quality education to my own children. Eventually, I was very proud of my job as a teacher and thought, well, what are these people doing who think they're homeschooling? How can they do what I've been trained to do and do a good job of it? And so I was one of those skeptical teachers who didn't understand what the homeschooling community was doing. It was through a progression of teaching in the school districts and teaching in various job capacities, and then eventually being hired at a homeschool assistance program that I came in close contact with some homeschool families and fell in love with the unique aspects I saw there. Just the way that the teenage children related to their parents and the quality connections they had and the ways that they related to their siblings in a way that they of course they had challenges and struggles, I grant you that, but they related to younger children and didn't look down the nose and put them down. And so I saw some unique things being developed and brought to the table in this homeschool option of education. And so I began to lay aside some of my skepticism, and I saw some quality thought processes and mentorships. And I myself, my daughter's watching my other two children tonight. They're not here, but I am so excited to say that she's going out and walking into job opportunities. She has confidence, and a lot of who she is today has a lot to do with what I've invested in her as a homeschool mom, but also I needed people like Carla Whitmer and RMCA to come alongside me in this journey, because I saw as the teen years emerged, we go through the same things all of you do. We get a teen who begins to emerge, and God granted them this ability to become an autonomous individual, where they start realizing, I know what I'm doing, and a mom, what does she know? And so we need some other people in our community. It's the African proverb says that it takes a village. And so in this village, I am so thankful to have the RMCA community coming alongside me and mentoring my children when they don't want, I mean, I have teaching textbooks. It's this little program that allows them to do their math. Well, my daughter would file her nails, and I said, honey, you really need to pretend that you have a teacher and you're writing some notes. Well, she ended up needing to do algebra again. And
thank you.
Oh, so anyway, wonderful option, the homeschool program. Tremendous. I can't say enough for it. They are coming along. My
thank
children
you.
Really are.
Now we are on to item 7.0, our action items. And as we have many here who aren't always at the meetings, and we love to see you all here, just as a general rule, we want you to make you aware that action items are usually discussed at work sessions prior. So they've been in two packets. So many of our questions have already been answered. We do tend to move through most of them fairly quickly, although I think there are a couple on here that we will be getting some updates on as well. So with that, may I have a motion for action item 7.01?
I move to approve the contract between District 49 and Community Partnership for Child Development for 2016-17.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any discussion? This is just the Head Start program in our district for anyone who's not aware. So this is in two of our schools to provide our preschool programs. And may I have a vote, please?
Butcher?
Aye.
Graham?
Aye.
Harold?
Aye.
Livia Wright?
Aye.
Moore?
Aye.
Motion carries. We're on to item 7.02, Action on Individualized Education Realignment Proposal.
I move to approve the revised job description and individualized education org chart in item 7.02.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any discussion? Hearing none, a vote, please.
Butcher?
Aye.
Graham?
Aye.
Harold?
Aye.
Livia Wright?
Aye.
Moore?
Aye.
Motion carries. We're on to action item 7.03, new job description.
I move to approve the instructional coach job description as recommended by the administration.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any discussion? And this is a job that already exists within the district. We have people already doing this. This is just making sure we have one common job description for all of those folks so that we can evaluate and hold everybody accountable to the same standard across the district. And with that, may we have a vote, please?
Butcher?
Aye.
Graham?
Aye.
Harold?
Aye.
Livia Wright?
Aye.
Moore?
Aye.
Motion carries. Item 7.04, action on school name change.
In accordance with policy FF, I move to approve a school name change from Patriot Learning Center to Patriot High School.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any discussion?
Yes. Mr. Franco and team, I had asked for your parental involvement and stuff. You provided that. I saw that it was very well captured. So thank you for that.
You're welcome.
Okay, if there's no other comment, then let's have a vote, please.
The reason why I brought that up was because it took a lot of effort, I think, to capture what I had requested, and they did it very well.
Okay, now we're ready for the vote.
Butcher?
Yes.
Graham?
Aye.
Harold?
Aye.
Livia Wright?
Aye.
Moore?
Aye.
Motion carries, and now we're on to action item 7.05. May I have a motion, please?
I move to approve the proposed high school homeschool program as presented as an amendment to the current charter contract to RMCA. Wait. Can I start over? Yes. I move to approve the proposed high school homeschool program as presented so an amendment to the current charter contract at RMCA can be made.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded, and I believe you're going to fill us in a little on this more.
I will. Annie Franco, iConnect Zone Leader, thanks. And thank you for the RMCA folks that came out tonight to speak on behalf of this program. The administration is in support of the program moving forward, and I think the purpose of the action item tonight is twofold. We would like to move the proposal in front of the board to get better clarification of what exactly is the homeschool high school program at RMCA, so that you're aware of that, and also to clean up the contractual language that's in the current charter. And so that would be kind of the phase two of this process for us. In the current contract, there is reference to high school education at RMCA, and it also references homeschool program at RMCA. What's not specified clearly is 9th through 12th grade education, and so we want to make sure that that is part of our contract so that we can better support the program and as well as better channel funding for that program. So one of the other items that was discussed was about highly qualified and certified teachers. Charter law does allow charter schools to, of course, waiver out of teacher certification, which is why we need to make sure that the 9th through 12th grade is specified in the charter contract, so that becomes an option. So administration is in support of this program and would like to see the board approve the proposal that has gone through the RMCA board and has been approved, and that way we can discuss the contract and move that forward to the State Board of Education, who does the approval of the waivers as well.
Now, in the contract, you listed your proposed teachers for it, or ones that are teaching now. And is that the concern? Because when I read them, they seemed perfectly qualified to be teaching.
Yeah. That wouldn't have been our major concern. Our major concern is just making sure that we've got clear language in the contract to make sure that we can fully support the program.
Well, I, for one, is, you know, Rocky Mountain, you guys have been doing a great job, really. I watch TV, okay, Family Feud, and you guys are on all the time. Really, you know, you guys are really attracting a lot of attention around Colorado Springs. You guys are doing a great job. And so I just want to thank you for your dedication to the kids in District 49 and around Colorado Springs too. So thank you very much.
I'm just really thankful for Rocky Mountain Classical Academy from where they came when they first started and all the ups and downs they've had. So it's really encouraging to see where they are now, and I'm thrilled for them.
I remember the bunkers.
Ms. Frank, now will we be bringing back an amended contract, or is the amended contract just going to the state?
No, we would be bringing back the amended contract for the board to approve.
Okay.
And the State Board of Education, the only reason I brought that up was because of the comment that, you know, there's some concern over teacher certification. It's a waiver process that needs to be gone through to secure that, which is heard by the State Board of Education. And there has been a rule change to how they're seeing and hearing those waivers this year, so that the State Board of Education is requiring an amendment to the contract when a waiver is presented. So we would be going through this process if there was just a waiver change as well.
Did you have a comment, Mr. Garner?
I do, and I represent Rocky Mountain.
Excuse me, could you state your name, voice?
Sorry. Robert Gardner for the Rocky Mountain Classical Academy. I'm sorry.
Was it that hard?
I was about to get there, Mr. Moore. I'm sorry. I guess I would take exception to the assertion, and maybe this needs to be hammered out, but I would just, I don't want the board to be misled that Rocky Mountain Classical Academy believes that this amendment would require approval by the state board. The current charter contract between Rocky Mountain Classical Academy and the district has a waiver provision for teacher tenure and certification. That was approved by the state board. The current contract references homeschool program and high school homeschool program. There has been some concern from the district, and I understand it, as to whether or not the high school homeschool program is clearly covered by the teacher tenure waiver within the charter contract, but that waiver is approved. It has been approved by the state board. It is part of your contract. And I do not believe, and we would take the position that once we do the charter amendment that says this is clearly part of Rocky Mountain Classical Academy's program, that that waiver that is in existence automatically applies and we can move on. I actually think that some of the comments at public comment period about that that seemed to be implying that there was less than full support have their genesis in this misunderstanding, and frankly, I would assert misunderstanding on the part of district administration that somehow we have to go back to the state board. But we can hammer that out. I just simply don't want the board tonight to be under the impression that we agree you have to go back to State Board of Education. Not at all. And I ask for your support, and I appreciate the opportunity to speak.
Anyone have any other further questions? Okay, I'm going to trust our administration to make sure the District 49 end is covered. Okay, and may we have a vote, please? Butcher?
Aye.
Graham?
Aye.
Harold?
Aye.
Livia Wright?
Aye.
Moore?
Aye.
Motion carries. We're on to item. (laughs) 7.06, action on policies supporting restorative practices.
I move to approve the three policies that support restorative practices in item 7.06.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any discussion? Okay, are these the only ones we're approved? These are the only policies we're approving tonight, right?
There's a another set. These are restorative. Okay.
Right. Okay. Yeah, I just couldn't remember if there's one or two. So I'll talk about my other thing at the other things. Okay. Anyone have any questions for Dr. Fletcher?
Yes, I had some, thinking as far as the protection of teachers, but I talked to Dr. Fletcher. I really believe in this program, Restorative Practices. So I believe it's going to work for the benefit of the teachers and the students. So it's a great program, really well thought out. So thank you guys, and I don't know where Dr. Fletcher is, but just say thank you to him, you know what I mean? Thank you, Dr. Fletcher, thank you very much.
Yeah. Okay, any other questions, concerns, or comments?
I just have one quick comment. Although it says it is expected that students will demonstrate respect for persons in authority, not cause harm to themselves or peers, I would also say that students will demonstrate respect not only for persons in authority, but for students and themselves. That's all I got to say about that.
Okay, anything further? Okay, then may we have a vote, please. Butcher?
Aye.
Graham?
Aye.
Harold?
Aye.
Livia Wright?
Aye.
Moore?
Aye.
Motion carries, and may I have a motion on 7.07, policy review.
After review and discussion at the prior work session, I move to approve the six policies listed in item 7.07.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any discussion? I have one comment, and it actually applies to both sets of policies. Because we've had this discussion previously, and that is we need these policy changes to be disseminated to our staff and our stakeholders when they affect them. And we used to have a great process in place to do that. And I don't know that it's happening as well anymore. We used to do some type of a policy update. And I think as personnel shifted, that stopped. And so I'm wondering where we are in the status of that, because I believe that comes under HR, which is under Mr. Hiltz, correct? Or no, that's under Brett now, isn't it? So, hey, Brett, this is now your tasking. Because I know that has been, I think everyone else is still in the same place. Is that the consensus still?
Yes.
That we need these disseminated to people as they're adopted. And so people are aware in plain speak of what changes impact them. And so can we restart that process?
Certainly, I don't think anyone would disagree with that. And unless Paul has any particular comment, you know, we will take that offline and engage on that.
Okay, hopefully before August. That's my only comment. Anyone have anything else to add?
May I clarify, is it the expectation of the board that we are disseminating these policy updates to staff members? You said people that are affected by them, which would also include students and parents, depending on the policy.
I think if there's a significant policy shift, we need to be informing the people impacted by it. So yeah, because if you're a parent who said, I looked at the policies when my kid started school and now there's something and I walk in and I have one version and the principal's telling me something with another, we want our stakeholders to know what they're responsible for. So if it's a policy that directly impacts that student, I think yes. Personally, I think yes, is that where other people are?
Then to clarify, I think you're tasking all of the chief officers, because HR and communications, although they have a supervisory relationship, communications is going to have a big part. And I supervise communications, but they really serve all three offices. So I just wanted to put myself on the same book with Brett. And I'll drag Jack along as well, because flag display is a facilities issue.
Well, and some of the employees who may be notified that something's different work there. And so if a policy changes and then someone tries to hold them accountable to a policy and they read the old one and not the new one, that's not fair. So our goal is to, and let's all be honest, there's very few people pulling up the board agenda every month and looking at every single change we're making. And with the number of policies we have, we're updating, you know, if we're going to review them every 3 years, there's still probably 10 or 15 a month that we're looking at, and usually they're minor tweaks, but when it's something significant, I think people should know. All right, especially so now that we have that.
I was gonna tell you, our office sends all of our community an email every month after your meeting about the results of what you vote on, action item wise. And that does include policy updates, but we can beef that section up. So it's something that we're already doing, but maybe not to the detailed level that you would want. And historically, the open rate of those has been about 17% or so. So it's not that people haven't had the information, but we'll look at some additional techniques that we can use to help engagement with that.
Yeah. Well, and whether it needs to be, whether we want it buried in that email is the other question. Because I think it was a separate communication at one point. Because there are plenty of times where maybe there's next to nothing on here that anyone who's actively working in a classroom, for example, would want to look at. And then there'll be other times where it's something that definitely impacts them. And you all have to sort that out. You'll all know which of those things, like when there's a title change, right, does anybody really care other than us making sure it's technically correct? Probably not. When there's something that impacts what they're going to be held accountable to, it's a much bigger deal. Yet if it's in the same kind of email, and it's just the general board email, odds are they didn't even know we made the change still. So, and that's what that 17% is showing us. Right. So I just want to make sure we get back on that track of doing that, especially given we are changing some pretty major things as we move into restorative practices, student conduct changes, what we're expecting of staff is changing. But I think we got it. Thank you very much. Okay, and now I think we're ready for a vote.
Butcher?
Aye.
Graham?
Aye.
Harold?
Aye.
Livia Wright?
Aye.
Moore?
Aye.
Motion carries, sorry. And now we have one more, 7.07G.
I move to approve policy JLJ.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any discussion?
I had asked a question about the accountability of this policy, and I just wasn't sure if anything had been finalized about who was going to be keeping track of number, hours, of minutes, whatever it was, of activity.
No, we haven't built a process for that.
Is there a possibility of it just being a line in the ship? Seeing as we do the ships, which are the wellness part of the UIP. Because this was, I think this came about because we changed the wellness policy, because what most of what I read in JLJ used to be in the wellness policy. And then we divided the wellness policy into a policy and a reg, and some of that stuff somehow filtered out.
I might invite the board to task me to create an accompanying regulation, a dash R. I'm not sure putting it in the ship is the right place if we want to have active monitoring of it. For example, we've been doing fire drills and other kinds of preparedness drills for many years, and it won't be until next year that we systematically record and measure and monitor and learn from that, because we're getting better at all of that. So I might suggest a different process is better, not one that we would create in 3 or 4 days, but tasking me to create or to bring you back a dash R seems reasonable.
My only concern is if we have a policy that says we have to monitor how many minutes of activity at all different levels, if nobody's monitoring it, then why even have a policy if we're not keeping track of it? Because if anybody asked us, we would never be able to say that we're following the policy, because we don't have any data for it. So that was why I questioned it. So I think an R would be great.
I respect that concern.
Do we have consensus on that as a directive? Okay, so I see more than three heads nodding. So you have your tasking. And may we have a vote, please? Butcher?
Yes.
Graham?
Aye.
Harold?
Aye.
Olivia Wright?
Aye.
Moore?
Yes.
Motion carries. We're on to item 7.08, finally.
I move to approve the four course proposals in item 7.08.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any discussion?
I just want to comment that these are aviation courses, which I found super interesting that they're going to look at doing those. So.
It would have made high school far more engaging for me. That's why I did Civil Air Patrol.
Actually, I was going to ask if I could go to Vista Ridge in this class next, but very cool offering. Congratulations.
My husband would like to time travel back and be a high school student at Vista. Okay.
I would agree with the proposal in Vista that doing the instrument ground school is very important to do along with, you know, the regular ground school. I've done both.
Yes, and far beyond that as well. And may we have a vote, please?
Butcher?
Yes.
Graham?
Aye.
Harold?
Aye.
Olivia Wright?
Aye.
Moore?
Aye.
Motion carries. We're on to item 7.09, action on banning Lewis Ranch Academy land lease.
I move to approve the site lease between Falcon School District 49 and Banning Lewis Ranch Academy Building Corporation as presented.
Second.
Oops, it's been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? This is just moving forward on a contract extension that we had already discussed way back in the fall, and this is the next step that we need for them to be able to move forward with building the high school piece. And with that, may we have a vote, please?
Butcher?
Aye.
Graham?
Aye.
Harold?
Aye.
Olivia Wright?
Aye.
Moore?
Aye.
Motion carries, and we're on to 7.10.
I move to approve the purchase sale agreement between Banning Lewis Ranch Academy Building Corporation, Falcon School District 49, and MREC Oakwood Colorado Ranch LLC as presented.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any discussion? Hearing none, a vote, please.
Butcher?
Aye.
Graham?
Aye.
Harold?
Aye.
Olivia Wright?
Aye.
Moore?
Aye.
Motion carries. We're on to item 7.11.
I move to approve the First Amendment to Charter Contract as presented.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any discussion? Hearing none, a vote, please.
Butcher?
Aye.
Graham?
Aye.
Harold?
Aye.
Olivia Wright?
Aye.
Moore?
Aye.
Motion carries. We're on to item 8.0, information items. The first two are things that are solely for our information, 8.101 and 8.02. So that's just in our board packet. 8.03 is a process improvement update. These are policies. Our goal is to try and review our policies every 3 years. And some need to be revised and some come forward when we say, no, that policy looks pretty good. And so these are the ones that I believe are recommended just to move forward as reviewed because we don't have any changes that need to be made to them, correct?
Some of them were included with the restorative practices and because they're dash R's, they're just included in under this area versus a formal approval.
So then we are on to item 9.01, policy and procedure review. Did anyone have any questions on those two policy, or actually it's three, that were parent involvement policies? Anybody? Is Mr. Coleman here? Oh, Miss, okay.
These are policies related to Title I compliance. I'm sorry, my name is Amber Wetstein, Executive Director of Learning Services. These are policies that were updated related to Title I compliance. They're actually policies that have been in practice already, but we needed to formalize them in district policy. These policies actually are reviewed with parents on an annual basis at the school level.
Any other questions for anyone? Okay, then are we all okay to move them forward? So then can you please put these for action on July 14th? And our next is a safety and security update from Mr. Watson.
Hello. You probably don't recognize me just shaving my big mountain beard.
Remember to state your name.
I'm David Watson, Director of Safety and Security. And Mr. Pratt could not be here this evening. He is moving into a new home. Very excited for him. So we're going to make this really quick. This school year, we've had over 250 safe to tell reports. And our top two reported items in our safe to tells were somehow mental health or some type of mental health relation, either a suicidal check the welfare type of scenario. And the second was cutting. And then it went down from there to the bullying and some other categories. So I'll get you the full data here in the next month when I get it from Safe to Tell. The emergency drills went very well this year, especially the unannounced lockdown drills. I know our principals love when they see my team walk into the school building with the clipboards. They know what's about to happen. And I get that a little bit afterwards. They're thinking they're having a remedial training when I'm coming back into the building. So emergency drills went very well this year. We're up in the ante this coming school year. Starting in the second week of school, our school principals can expect up until fall break time that my safety team and I will be showing up and conducting an unannounced drill of some type to make sure that we keep our preparedness up. It's important. Training's up there. We had a great year of training this year. Myself, Dr. Lou Fletcher, Zach Craddock, Amy Craig, and Dr. Kim Boyd and David Pratt conducted threat assessment training in preparation for Claire Davis Senate Bill 213, 214 coming up in about 13 months. That will kick in July of 2017. And we are gonna continue that this coming school year with our district professional development days. Our first one's gonna be at the end of August. And we will have 4 hours training that morning on threat assessments. And so we're excited about continuing that and really enhancing that program, especially with our new crisis team that we've established. We're really excited about having them come on board. And then our security officer training will be conducted again at the end of July, as we usually do. And we are up in the ante on that training as well. We are actually on our second day bringing in some specialists out of Denver, and they're going to conduct a tactical medical course for our staff. And at the end of the course, they'll get a tactical medical bag. So that, you know, they can have that experience with that training in the event the unfortunate happens at one of our schools. They'll be prepared to deal with it. And then One of the things that Dave Pratt and I discussed towards the end of the school year was resiliency. And we started talking about not only the resiliency in our students, but with our staff. They start getting tired at the end of the school year and they need that refresh. And so we're bringing some resiliency and officer survival training to our security officers this summer. And so we're real excited about that. Threat mental health assessments. I don't want to steal anyone else's thunder on Zach's team, but we had well over 300 of those assessments this school year, which is good. You would think that you would want a lower number, but in our world, that means people are looking out for one another and they're telling people that my friend's in crisis and needy help. So we looked at as a positive, not as a negative, that our kids are actually getting the help that they need. Additional training requirements. I just spoke of what we're going to do with our security officers and with our staff district wide at our public or our PD day. And again, we're preparing for the Claire Davis Act. And we mentioned the district crisis team, which will be on board after July 1st. And we will start training with them probably mid-July. And Dave Pratt and I attended a very good training this past Monday. It was called Mental Health, or it's Youth First Aid Mental Health. And it was basically talking about recognizing the signs of distress and what to do. And so we piloted that class, if you will, by going to it and checking it out. And so our goal is to bring that to our crisis team, as well as to our teachers in the district. Unannounced drills, we just talked about CESI. So Mr. Pratt on Monday night had his first soccer event at Evans Elementary School, and it was a great success. They had 40 neighborhood kids show up at the school. There were a lot of parents there, a lot of non-dry eyes. The parents just loved seeing their kids out on the field and engaged in a positive activity, which is extremely exciting for our school district. And we are the first school district in the city of Colorado Springs to bring the CESI program to our school district. And for those of you in the audience that don't know what CESI is, my partner Dave Pratt's not here, and but it's a soccer initiative that he's a part of. He is a retired Colorado Springs police officer, a big soccer fan, and he partners with all the fourth judicial, as well as the professional and AAA affiliate of the soccer team here in town, Switchbacks. Thank you. Switchbacks are heavily involved, and they basically come out and they take children who don't have a lot of positive things in their lives, and they can come to the park and they outfit them with cleats. Every kid gets a ball to go home and practice with. And it's a great initiative, and it's a really wonderful thing to see. And I'm so happy for School District 49 being the first school district to bring this here. They're in a lot of southern parks. We are, I believe, the fifth or the sixth location. And most of the parks are down south and in the middle part of Colorado Springs, like Murray and some of those locations at city parks where the children are in those neighborhoods can walk to those parks. And so we're very fortunate to have it at Evans Elementary School to serve off of Peterson and the Powers Corridor. DSEM, which is District Safety Emergency Management. We met this year and we merged with Restorative Practices Committee, and it was some great times in that committee talking about policies, procedures, and moving forward with our emergency procedures. And Tara from Facilities, our safety compliance officer, has stepped up, and she's a part of that now. So our two departments have merged, and sort of, and we are working together on quite a few initiatives, which is exciting. And the last one up there is dashboard tracking production. One of the things that came out with the REMPEX was, hey, Dave, Safety and Security Department, great plans, but how do you prove what you did? Or how do you show us your production? And so we have sought out two different ways to track that. We are bringing School Dude, Crisis Manager app to our school district. We are still working on how that's gonna really integrate But the other piece to that, what we have already started working on 3 days ago, we worked with Mr. Brian Green, and we created two groups in Schoology. And those two groups are assigned, one's to myself and Dave Pratt, and the other one's going to be for all of our principals and admin team. And we're going to be able to dashboard track our KPIs out of those two groups based off of a questionnaire that Dave Pratt and I fill out every time we go to a school. We fill one out that tracks our productivity. And then our principals will be filling one out every time they conduct a drill or a real life incident, as well an after actions report, which they've been doing. It's just we haven't had a really good cataloging location for that. And so we just discovered how well Schoology will work with us, or with our product that we are needing. So we're excited about that. That's all I got.
Wait a minute, you finished 3 minutes early?
So say, I'm really impressed.
It's summer break. Yeah, that's it.
Smooth face, smooth presentation.
I would like to encourage you on the mental health assessments. We saw some suicides in the larger community at the end of the school year. And that's really important. That's probably the biggest tragedy we could experience.
Correct. And I don't want to spend too much time talking about it now. I did brief Mr. Hiltz this evening on something that will be happening in the community coming up soon. I did speak to both of our Colorado Springs Police and Sheriff's Office counterparts today, and they are putting together a plan. And they want the schools and the directors of security all to come together and work together on this initiative in the city. So there will be something coming forward.
That's good news. Thank you.
So thank you.
Okay, and so our next item is the budget and DAC review for the 2016-17 school year. As we pointed out earlier, this is the busiest time of the year really for the business office, as they're closing out 1 year and having to have the entire budget ready for the following.
Brett Ridgeway, Chief Business Officer. Ron Sprins as the Finance Group Manager may or not be here. I think he's doing his own baseball coaching as well tonight. So we have an extended time on your agenda tonight to talk about budget. This is the last time we'll really have a discussion, if you will, before we approve the budget at the next special meeting on June 22nd. And so the biggest section we want to have here is the presentation that comes from the DAC. And we have the subcommittee at the DAC called the Budget Subcommittee, actually known as the Bud Sub. And I don't know, maybe it's just me calling them that. But this year we added a big job to their tasking this year, to have the MLO op oversight as well. And so it's really been a great committee and a great process, much bigger, much more involvement than we've had in the past years. And so that's been really great. And hopefully, you know, these folks can, you know, give you their impressions of that. We have three members of that group here today, led by DAC legend Al Cox and Erica West as the chair of the DAC. And John here is a great contributor to the committee. I really appreciate his insight to it. So I will leave these guys to walk you through these slides here, and you can engage with them on that. And then I'll come back for some of the other budget items we have later in the package.
Hi there, I'm Al Cox. I am the community representative to the DAC, and I've been here involved in the school district for 22 years. The first board meeting that I went to was back in the spring of 1994, and I gotta thank the board members for doing such a great job, because I can tell you, having suffered through 22 years of some of these boards, you guys are doing a great job in comparison to some of the other ones. That was a tumultuous time back then, and it's not tumultuous now. So congratulations to all of you. And also to Brett and to Peter and to Jack, you guys really are doing a good job in comparison to the administrations that we had in the past. So thank you very much. We as the DAC budget committee, we asked the schools and the SACs if they could give us the community's input into where the budget should be focusing its attentions. And they each give us inputs what I feel like we should do is, this is my roll up of the inputs. They're just kind of getting an overall view of where they think that we should be spending our money. So you kind of get a good picture of the fact that they want to focus on curriculum, on the technology, keep going forward with things. And there are some staffing focuses that we need to work on, all the way down to making sure that we're taking care of the security and safety of the kids. The rest of these things are actually each individual school's, preferences as far as what they want to have the budget focus on. So I'm going to slip through them, and if you have anything that you want to ask about, go ahead. If not, we didn't get the acronyms taken care of, so I'm going to have to take it. This is Springs Ranch Elementary School and their focuses. You see two of the safety issues. Snow removal equipment is kind of interesting, but you know, we would like to get safety for the schools that, for the kids there. You will see math and interventionists quite a number of times there, as long as, and also the Chrome cards. Okay, next one. Skyview Middle School. And again, safety and security curriculum. And they, well, I think that the bottom one, the building technology is interesting. And so you may want to take a look at that, because leave it at that. Now, here's one thing with Vista Ridge. This is what they were, we left the lined out items in here, but these were items that have already been taken care of. So that's why they are lined out, okay? I think they were taken care of through the MLO money, okay? And then the line, the items that are grayed out are items they put on the list, but they're not necessarily appropriate, they're facility type of things that we didn't think were appropriate for the general fund, okay? So that's what you're seeing here. So the idea, the items that are still in dark are the things that they would, that would fit the budget subcommittee recommendations, okay? This is Meridian Ranch's input. And again, you will see the core knowledge and language arts things in a number of the schools. So please take that in mind. It seems to be a high priority for the schools. And also the getting math intervention is one of the things that you're gonna see a number of times. Next. Thank you. Falcon Elementary, FESOT was something that I said, I have no idea what that acronym is. I had to ask Heather to give me what this means. I mean, this, things change, and I go back to way back when. I had no idea what FESOD was. So, but again, you seeing the ELA curriculum, professional development, getting our teachers the training that they need, and again, technology. Woodland Hills Elementary School. Let's see. Again, you're seeing the ELA professional development and technology. Next one. Falcon Middle School. Okay. Falcon High. Again, you're seeing the math interventions. Math 180 is one that you'll see a couple of times. Whoops. Okay. And then one of the things we did have a discussion on was the tutoring after school. We actually felt that this was something we'd like you guys to really look at, okay, as we went through the discussions. Next one. The Spring Studio, okay. Again, the grayed out areas are things that we felt that you, that were capital, okay. And then the focus on technology, curriculum, and staffing. Okay. And I do appreciate the fact that I think this may be the last school board meeting that I'm going to ever attend. So thank you very much for your time, guys.
Thank you for your time. 22 years of investment.
Hi, I'm Erica West. I'm the DAC chair. After the last DAC meeting, or last MLO budget subcommittee meeting, we did receive a few schools' spending priorities. So these were not reviewed by the budget subcommittee or by DAC. So Remington Elementary School, Evans, and they all base the curriculum, the staffing, and the security are all the Horizon Middle School, Sand Creek, and then Ridgeview, Odyssey, Stetson. All right. And the MLO, I want to just say that the MLO process that we went through was very enlightening and very informative. And it helped me understand where money's really going to what. So thank you for involving us.
John Newbill, I'm a DAC representative of Woodman Hills Elementary School. I'd just like to echo what Erica just said, you know, as far as the MLO process, is that we have standardized quite a few things, and Brett and Heather have been very supportive with that, whether it's getting us information or standardized formats. And if there's ever a question about whether or not there is a critical look at these things, we do take a critical look, and I think any of the zone leaders would attest to that as well. So if there's ever a question, just send them my way. Thank you.
I'd like to thank the members of the DAC for your hard work, and especially the mill levy override committee and the budget subcommittee. And Al, it has been a pleasure. Thank you. Did you inform your cohorts that they have to do 22 years before they get released?
That's up to you.
Thank you much. Appreciate your efforts, Al.
Again, I appreciate these folks coming out. And Eric, I hear this is, it's not your birthday. It is your birthday. So. So that's fantastic dedication. Thank you very much for coming here with this motley crew on your birthday. So again, you know, having presented that stuff to you, you know, that's kind of your opportunity to have heard information directly from the community through the arms of the DAC, as well as what you've been presented from the administration in terms of the budget. So you know, as you have the chance in between now and the next meeting to contrast and compare, you know, that's the opportunity to have questions that go to zone leaders, to principals, to myself and Ron, you know, about how some of these priorities that have been surfaced have been handled, or if there's reasons that they were handled differently. So that's your tasking from here to then.
My question would be, how many of those things, of those things listed by the DAC, how many of those things are already addressed in the budget?
I believe a great many of them are. Zone leaders, do you want to head nod or one way or the other?
Because I would think like most of the curriculum things, I think most people already had in. I know CKLA, most have already reinvested in from what I was even hearing at the reading instruction. And that's only one of several different reading programs our schools are using. And those are determined at the building level by the teachers and principals and zone leaders together based on their student populations. So CKLA is one of several. Some just weren't specifically named there.
You know, when I looked at it, a lot of it was technology and math. Okay. You know, and that seemed like a theme that I've heard all, you know, this evening. Technology and math, science, you know, that the schools need some help in that type of area. Mm-hmm. Sounds like STEM to me. I'm just throwing it out there. Okay. But, you know, maybe that's something that we can start looking at, like we looked at the reading, you know, a little bit more, especially math. It seems like that's a needed area. It's been a consensus through the DAC that that's what they're looking at. So
when you hear the primary literacy report, what you're going to hear is that as we make progress on tackling that focus area, there will be a point where we will have made enough progress that we can start refocusing, and math instruction would be logically next. And so what you're hearing from zone leaders, some of the things in these budget proposals are pilots. So let's try out a program, let's try out a technology, so that when we are ready when we're in our third or fourth year of using CKLA and we've spent the money on the training and some of the materials and the things that aren't consumables, then we'll have some insight and we'll know which math program to make a bigger investment. So the author Jim Collins in a book, Great by Choice, talks about this strategy as you fire a BB, you get it on target, and then you fire a cannonball. So right now what you're seeing is quite a few BBs going out. Let's test these programs, let's pilot them, so that when we have freed up the resources of focus and money, then we're ready to fire cannonballs at math the way we have been at literacy.
Very good, thank you. So the other pages that we have here in the board packet tonight, this section of pages here is what Ron Sprantz has been putting together to have a summary view towards the front of the budget package. And so he had walked you through some of the general fund versions that he had put in the package back in May. And so these focus on the other funds. And so, you know, typically you'll see the fund number up here in the blue. And this is really meant to be a simpler current picture view. You know, a lot of the pages we have to have in the budget package by statute have to have several years of information on there. So it ends up getting it to be a really busy schedule to cover that statutory requirement. This could end up being more informative on a current basis as to what has happened this year, what are we talking about next year type of thing. So I believe that's his intent with these pages here. So you see every single fund will have this this summary level view in it, and then we'll have the detail pages further back in the budget package. This page this of course has my signature all over it, right? Small print, lots of stuff on there. Yeah.
This page, zoom in, it just gets blurry.
So this is a single page, and the reason I wanted to have this in obviously is for you to be looking at it offline. But this represents nutrition services program. And this is just really meant to, again, communicate the level of detail and work that we go through with Monica and her department to talk about on a school by school basis, meal by meal, and what is the budget for that. So we're not just throwing $3 million or $3.5 million, whatever the revenue number is that we put out there. We have a lot of information, a lot of detail that we put in behind it. You know, what are the number of free lunches? What are the number of reduced lunches? What is the reimbursement rate for each of those? You know, there's a lot of information, a lot of structure that goes in behind that. And so we've had this periodically in the regular financial report, but really the most important version of this is a budget version of this that says here's where we believe we're headed this year, because that's again how she's going to staff. That's what's going to drive the expense load that's going to be put into that same fund for that program. So this is again for your reference going forward. The last section I wanted to highlight tonight is what is now Fund 15, used to be Fund 21, which is the capital reserve budget. This is where we take about $3.5 million right now is our annual allocation, revenue allocation from the general fund into this fund specifically to address items of concern in the capital in the facility program. This is what gives Jack his to-do list for the summer, especially are these monies and these projects. So this is the original budget presentation or recommendation from the staff, from the administration as to what projects are going to be focused on this year and how much they're going to be spending on each of those. There's also a section in here, like we've had before, of things that we believe are good recommendations for future MLO op coverage. And so I've spoken to, I think the two main zone leaders in here, Blair and are with the Power Zone and the Falcon Zone, and I've spoken to them about these possibilities. And so we'll be working on that going forward as well. So I wanted to call this list of projects to your attention before we actually approve the budget then in a couple weeks.
Were you able to clarify that one project? because it was kind of grouped with power zone, but listed as Falcon Zone, the lightning mitigation one?
Yes, that lightning mitigation. Let me see if I can find it here on Falcon Middle School. Yeah.
So is it, so it's Falcon Middle for
it's
sure?
Falcon Middle, isn't it? Lightning mitigation.
Or is that Stetson Elementary?
Right.
Right, but it says Falcon Middle School,
Falcon Middle School,
and then it's grouped with Power Zone, and it's 2i Connects first. So I didn't know if it's really...
It got out of sort because of the zone coding, but it's Falcon Middle School.
Zone leaders.
Yeah, our main area is really this, the area in Falcon is really predominantly what we're getting hit with. So we're, you know, focusing on that initially, but that is Falcon Middle School.
Okay, perfect.
Yeah, so I'm sorry that's missorted in here as a result. So I can correct
and that. A lot of that is, you know, some of it stems, I think, really from our old Trillion Towers that hopefully in about the next 6 years we'll be able to get rid of.
Yeah.
Okay, anyone have any questions on this today?
One of the things maybe I could just highlight one in particular right here, that's right in the middle on this particular page is Falcon Legacy Campus and a significant investment being made there. That would be with the focus and the changing of the programs coming up on speed there this coming year. So to have PPAC, you know, Pikes Peak Early College, to have some expansion of the homeschool program, and then to have Patriot High School reformatted and put into that building. So this is some good investment that's necessary for those programs to run well this fall.
Anyone have any further questions on this or any of the other part of the budget? Because we'll be approving at the special meeting on the next at the next meeting. We're having a special meeting immediately before the work session, right at the same time as we would normally start, because we have some things we have to take action on. And it's easier to just add a special and then do your work session than have a different meeting on a different day. So. Okay, so I think we're ready to move that forward then, please.
Thank you.
And so we're on to item 9.04, the Sand Creek High School waiver request.
Good evening, members of the board. My name is Aria Shrey Bartlett, and I'm the Freshman Academy teacher leader.
And I'm Janet Giddings. I'm an associate principal at Sand Creek High School.
We want to thank you for the opportunity to come back to you with some clearer, more defined answers to your questions. So just kind of as a recap, we wanted to talk about how this leadership model is kind of the next phase in a teacher-led building. We also wanted to let you know that, again, we heard the concerns, not only that you had, the concerns and questions that you had, that our SAC had, that our teachers had. We took all of that into consideration as we worked on those documents that you received. I wanted to draw your attention to the distributed proposed leadership duties and just give you kind of an example of what that would look like for teacher leaders. So in this document that you received, specifically what I wanted to address is for Freshman Academy, since that's my baby, so to speak. So last year, teacher leaders would have say control in areas that related to their program or their school. So for me, my program is Freshman Academy. This year we focused on staff development for our Freshman Academy teachers. We worked with Stan Richardson and we did learning walks to kind of focus in and narrow on components that we felt were crucial to the development of our teachers and to the significance in learning for our students.
All right, and then based on feedback from the board's last meeting and also from our SAC, we included for you our organizational chart.
It's based on our areas of impact and expertise, and it clarifies the chain of command. Each department you can see has an associate principal designated as a liaison. For consistency and to honor the relationships that we've worked so hard to build, each AP actually kept their evaluees from this year. The only thing we did differently was we took Mr. Hamilton's evaluees and anybody who was being replaced. And if they were in your area that you were liaison for, then you're evaluating them. So any new hires in math or science, for instance, or anybody that Mr. Hamilton had been evaluating in math or science, for instance, are now going to be mine. But otherwise, we're keeping our evaluees because we honor those relationships. And then we also have the decision-making matrix for you. And I just wanted to highlight a couple of things. I'm not sure I know how to make the clicker work. Do you press the right arrow? No, to make the laser thing? Oh, there it is. Oh, thank you. Sorry. So professional learning or professional development, you can see, for instance, is a joint decision of the Sand Creek leadership team. And the Sand Creek leadership team is made up of associate principals and teacher leaders with the input of the campus council that's replacing our faculty leaders, as well as content and grade level teams. So, for instance, if the algebra team feels that they need professional development and effective assessments, then that's something that as a joint decision-making team with the teacher leaders and the associate principals we would make. And the other one I wanted to highlight for you was, for instance, student conduct, sorry, is a decision of just the associate principals, okay? And then finally, our outcomes remain the same as from our last presentation. We welcome the ability to be held accountable for these. We want to focus on student achievement. Our entire Sand Creek leadership team is here with us today, with the exception of Ms. Sides, who I don't see, right? No, Ms. Sides. And we are eager to answer your questions. We appreciate the opportunity to come before you tonight. Do you have questions for us?
Where you say joint decision, Sand Creek leadership team, APs and TLs, is that done by majority vote, supermajority?
It's going to.
How's it done?
I would also like to highlight that's a draft document. Obviously, we're going to have to work through some of these things throughout the year, but the current thought is that's going to be a consensus vote. So we argue to consensus, we resolve in the meeting, we come out as a united front.
What happens when you don't come out as united front? Does it get upped?
Luckily, there's seven of us, so there's always will be a majority rule. But we can, and if someone needs to take it higher, we certainly can do that. We're a very collaborative group. We do have a new teacher leader with us for next year. Mr. Brandt will be replacing Mr. Matea, who has retired. So we've already been working together for a year, and I don't anticipate there will be very much, severe headbutting.
And if you, I know you have said before that you started student engagement. Have you started parent engagement?
With the exception of the SAC, I would have to say no. Mr. Smith is taking on our SAC for us. He's the teacher leader for advanced academics. And I would have to say that it's going to look a little different starting next year. And so we have not engaged the parents nearly as much as we would like to have. But for moving forward for next year, absolutely, there'll be a main focus for the SAC.
I have to say at the SAC meeting, because I attended it, there was some good suggestions from the SAC on how to present that to parents over the summer and moving forward. And there were talking about moving it down even into the middle school so that parents understand as they're coming into Sand Creek what the expectations are. So I was pretty happy with what a lot of the SAC conversations were, and that was very productive.
Thank you. I would also like to point out, we do have a community liaison, which we put in place halfway through this year, but she'll be there all of next year. Lauren Stewart, and she's really good at communications. She's working on an app for us, which parents and students and faculty can use to give you updates on various things.
And when I had congratulated Andy Franco on his outreach to the community, that was also in preparation for just reminding you that that's very important.
I did note that when you said that to Mr. Franco, and I thought, I should probably look into that. Yep, thank you.
Further questions from anyone?
I had one clarification just to make sure I understand. A parent's going to have one chain, right? So like they have an issue, that person had, that individual has, so that individual associate principal has the final say. They're not going to be able to go play mom against dad kind of thing with all of y'all.
Right.
Right. And that looked like it was divided by alphabet.
Right. So if it's a discipline issue, their main contact would be the dean associated with the last name. If it's a, for instance, an issue with a teacher or over a curriculum, then their main point of contact would be the associate principal associated with that last name. But regardless of who they contact, even if they got the wrong person, the deans and the associate principals are tasked with being the point person from that point on and bringing in whoever needs to be to resolve the issue, but not making the parent hop through a bunch of hoops and, oh, you shouldn't be talking to me. You need to be talking to somebody else instead.
That's a double-edged sword in terms of my I get concerned about that mom playing dad thing of if they figure out who the easy touch is, and certainly my kids know which of us is an easy touch on which things. Dad is on some things and I'm on the others. They may figure out who to call first. And so I would say think about that piece and then think about how that plays out with families, with children with last names that begin with different letters, because right. You can have kids with three different last names in the same family. So think through both the positive, just think through the pieces of how, I would think ahead so that you have it problem solved ahead of time and have a plan for how the four of you will come together as United Front in those pieces, because those are precisely the situations that will challenge the weak part of it. And prior planning can help mitigate some of that. I didn't have a question more that isn't necessarily on your piece of it, but it's more for upper level administration, because as I was looking at supervisory duty and evaluative duty, Mr. Dorsey's workload is jumping substantively. Because it looked to me like he's going from evaluating the principal in that building, which is one person, to evaluating seven. And if I look at the workload and efficiency and just compare it to the other zones, so this isn't a person comment, but just looking at position comment, I'm a little concerned about how we make sure that that is done effectively and with the appropriate support, because I know it's difficult to give enough support to five principals and other staff that work with you. So I know you have Kids Corner and another person, I think at least under you. Zone leaders also have other people under, other zone leaders also have typically six or seven total. And so the level of support, both in terms of a new program and then the level of evaluation we're needing and whether we need to think through that a little more carefully. And that's not necessarily a hold up on the waiver, but personally, and I'd need to know where other people kind of are on this. So in terms of whether it turns into a tasking of, can we look at how we're doing that evaluation piece and how to distribute that workload? Kevin, you look like you want to say something.
Yeah, I was going to kind of wait towards the end to bring it up, but the waiver is from, you know, the structure of the waiver is that the, you know, the zone leader steps in as the principal when there is no principal, kind of a temporary thing, because that's a lot of pressure, a lot of direct reports. I mean, are we under this structure, are we actually waiving that, or is are we looking at the zone leader is going to act more like the principal in this role with the thing? So, or am I missing something on the clarity of the number of direct reports?
I wouldn't say that you're missing something, but I would say that
kind tonight.
Asking the zone leader to formally by policy act as the principal is a bigger workload than what this model. So this model empowers this team, this campus leadership team, to function as a principal. So where you see JD down the middle of that chart, joint decision, think of that as a person named JD. I don't know who he or she is, but JD is going to make a lot of decisions. And those are decisions that under the current policy would fall to the zone leader. So we're actually interposing the campus leadership team so that fewer things get to the zone leader. So I'm answering your question. I'm not really answering the question of span of control and workload, but I will say that in Sand Creek Zone, it has been a long time since one person evaluated one administrator. They do instructional rounds, they do administrative rounds. The principal at the middle school has input on the evaluation of a colleague at the elementary school and vice versa and round robin. So it is true that the evaluator of record will be Mr. Dorsey under this model as we transition, I believe in another year, perhaps to, it's part of what we learn as we innovate, but we will transition to a point where more of the active evaluation is done by peers within this model, but as a way of establishing continuity and maintaining a single belly button to push, for me, that will be important in terms of my span of control. Having Mr. Dorsey as the evaluator of record is a necessary transitional form. But I do not expect him to be the primary author of all of the things that go into evaluation. And this campus leadership team is explicitly asking to supervise themselves. So I'm differentiating now supervision and evaluation. Evaluation rests with Mr. Dorsey. Supervision is a collective function under what they're asking for.
Well, it seems like, you know, the meaning of innovation is that you're taking innovative steps and doing different things, and nothing, you know, you don't know exactly how certain things are going to work out, you know, before you implement them. And so you have to monitor them to make sure that they're all working out. So we have to trust you guys, in other words, that you're going to be monitoring this and evaluating this correctly, and making sure that Mr. Dorsey is not overworked and doing many different things that he's not doing now. So, you know, we have to just trust you guys with it, right?
Trust but verify. And I think it would be reasonable for us to come back to you. Normally a zone would come and report twice a year, but maybe you want to have a Sand Creek campus report specifically on this model sooner than that. And I would invite you to invite us back to talk about how this is going. But span of control, the number of direct reports, that's something we've been talking about in the 3 years that I have been here. I've asked you to reduce my number of direct reports. We've asked to manage that with other zone leaders. So I think just for consistency's sake, we shouldn't pretend this isn't an issue. This is an issue. It's one that Mr. Dorsey and I have talked about, and the campus leadership team and I have talked about. And so it's something that we do need to pay careful attention to.
Well, and forgive me, but because I know we looked at some job descriptions for pieces of this a long time ago, but how is teacher leader distinguished from teacher in job description, and how is that set up in terms contractually? Do you know what I mean? So like, there are certain things we're obligated under in TECTA, for example, that we can move people in some ways and not in others based on TECTA rules, right? And so what pieces of their job description are covered by TECTA, and are other parts things that are like extra duty stipends or something that gives us a different range of legal responsibility and requirement and obligation in terms of position? I'm probably saying it a little too convoluted.
I understand your question. I think there's a very straightforward answer, and I would trust Mr. Anderson to correct my understanding and improve my answer. But essentially the answer is this, that once a teacher is employed by a district and has achieved non-probationary status, whether they are promoted or consigned to an administrative position or not, let's say that they became a principal and there came a point where they said, I don't want to be a principal, we are still obligated to employ them as a teacher. And right. So you all are familiar, I think, with some examples where we've had principals who returned to classrooms. So that doesn't change whether they're called an associate principal or a coach or a teacher leader or a teacher. Having established a property right to employment as a teacher, they retain that property right even through other possible assignments. Mr. Anderson, can you just nod if I got that mostly right?
So I guess my question is, do they retain a property right to teacher leader or only to teacher?
They are okay. A teacher. That's the that TECTA, the Teacher Employment Compensation Act, speaks to the role of teacher in multiple assignments, but that's the role.
I know it's really technical, but it's kind of important given lots of court decisions that have come down to make sure we have a lot of clarity around those pieces for everybody. Not because I'm imagining a problem, but I like to be proactive and know exactly what we're doing ahead of time.
Well, I just want to say, I know many of you, and I've talked to you at the school through different times, and so I've been hearing about this much longer than probably other board members might have been. So I'm more familiar with it, and I'm probably more comfortable with moving forward with this because I do know you, and I respect how you've handled this last half of the year and how you've been already pretty much doing this. So I come at it from a different perspective than some other board members. But for me, having a kid in the school and knowing you individually and what you've been doing, I have great expectations and high hopes for this, and I encourage you to continue with the passion you have for this.
Thank you. Anyone else have any questions?
Is there going to be a guiding document or a charter, so to speak, business rules that basically are written down to say how things are going to be done?
Do you mean like for our meetings or the decision-making matrix or?
Yeah, roles, responsibility, like a matrix is fine, but roles and responsibilities.
Yeah, we have the, and it's still a draft, but okay. We did do a lot of changes to it based on input from staff, mm-hmm. From the board, from the June meeting, and also from our SAC. But that's the proposed duties and responsibilities. That's that 3-page document in your packet.
Okay. And so also I saw there was some dissenting votes from both the teachers and the SAC.
Yep.
So are we going to hear what those dissenting opinions are as well and how you're going to address them?
We
if they're
certainly,
able to be addressed?
The vote for the staff would be difficult to know what their dissenting opinions were because it was just a yes or no ballot. I mean, we would know some stuff anecdotally. We did have a Google survey that they could write their information in. Mr. Grant, was that 9 people that submitted information for that? Yeah, 7 people. And we had more than, and some of those votes, some of those comments, sorry, were positive, and some of those comments seemed to indicate that the people did not support the waiver request, but we had more people not support the waiver request than 7. So it would be hard to get the information from the teachers because it was just a yes, do you support this, or no, I don't support this. And again, from the SAC, that was anecdotal as well. And the one person who voted against it, I could ask why. I don't, Mr. Smith, do you remember off the top of your head why that was? Clear enough. Yeah, I don't know if you heard Mr. Smith, but his comments in the SAC were related to the fact that the organizational chart and the decision-making matrix weren't clear enough.
And so you have comments like that, and you know, the comments about span and control and documenting, you know, so basically there's no doubt who is doing what. You know, one of the things we do in the military is, you know, we identify what we call gaps and seams. You know, I think I may have mentioned that, you know, the first time you brought this up, and that's just basically identifying what could possibly go wrong. Every little thing, whether it's probable or not, but it's possible. And then having an answer for it will may help you win those people over.
Thank you.
Okay, so anyone have any other questions? Okay, so at this point we have to do some direction and tasking and see if there's anything else we need. So we have a couple of things on the table. Is there anything else anyone specifically needs before moving the waiver piece forward? Kevin, do you need anything else?
No, I'm pretty good. I went to the SAC meeting that night, and I saw in this presentation the issues that were raised at SAC have been reflected in here, and I think it was a very good response. I won't go into everything I said. They don't want to hear it again.
We appreciate your attendance.
My daughter's afraid she'll flunk next year after I show up to a meeting, so give her D's. No, but I think you've done a good job, and you know, you've given yourself a lot of work for your summer break to get ready for the fall. Congratulations, and you know, measuring the outcomes, and what some of my tech friends say, hope you succeed if you don't fail quickly, you know. So good luck to you.
Thank you. John, anything else? Tammy, David?
No.
Okay, and then the second piece was, I brought up the span of control. Does anyone else want to hear anything back that would be separate from the waiver vote, but maybe something back from Peter on some kind of plan on how to look at and support that in terms of the evaluation piece and how much that's jumping?
I think it should be provided, what, you know, the evaluation piece as part of this.
So you want it? Well, I'm saying this would be separate from that's. It's kind of a separate issue because the waiver doesn't create this structure. The structure is separate. The waiver just lets them make the decision, but we can also task with a timeline to folks to say, come back and give us some information about how you're going to provide adequate support or planning around having 13 people to evaluate or 14 now instead of six. That's me as an individual, so I need to know whether there's consensus or not, because I'm not going to ask someone to do that without consensus.
Yeah, I would say yes to that. I would say I'd like, before the waiver vote, I would like to see the parental outreach. And I would also like to see what you're talking about after the waiver vote.
Okay.
Respectfully, Mr. Graham, this is a very, it is unlikely that we will get an honorable sampling of parent opinions this summer.
I'm not saying that you have to get all the parent opinions, but you have to do the outreach. You have to get the information out to them so that they know their kids are going to be in a school that is not going to have a principal. It's going to have a unique organization to it. So they should at least be contacted to say, this is what we're doing. It's going to come up for a vote.
Yes, sir.
And if you have anything to say, that's your time to say it.
And so our most likely moment to capture their attention is as students are returning to school. So that's about the last 5 days of July. We're on a trajectory to go forward. If the board moves this for action, perhaps at the special meeting or perhaps at the July meeting, we would be asking you to take action before the prime opportunity to communicate that to parents. So I think the question is whether you consider that outreach a condition of the waiver, or do you consider that a characteristic of the waiver that you would expect to see us implement if it is approved?
Can I interject? I'm sorry, Mr. Dorsey's reminding me that we did reach out to the parents with a global email. There was Twitter, there was Facebook. Thank you. They're reminding me of these things. From our community liaison, Lauren Stewart, prior to the SAC meeting, there was a huge push. I think there were two emails. There was Twitter and Facebook inviting them to come to the SAC because this was something that we were going to talk about. So thank you for reminding me about that.
Good. That's what I'm asking. Did you have people show up that were expressed concerns or support, or not yet?
Sorry to say, it was the same people that always come to the SAC. Well, not that we don't enjoy their presence, but nevertheless, that's who it was.
That's okay. If there's any input from the parents and whatnot, you know, as the waiver is coming up, if you're community director liaison, I'm not sure what the title is, could present that to us, or at least just talk about it. But the general consensus is, if there is one at that time, or just what kind of feedback you're getting, because I just find it, you're expecting us to vote on something that we may not have community input to. And I certainly have been a proponent that the board has to represent the community, the stakeholders. It's the teachers too, it's the staff too, but it's also the parents and the students and the businesses. So that's what I'm trying to get at. It's not a condition, but I just like to know where we stand when we come to vote on it.
I appreciate that. I want to reiterate, based off some of the input from community at the SAC meeting, provided it was the usual crowd that was there. I mean, it was very much what you guys are talking about. It was span of control. Where does the buck stop? What's the organizational chart look like? What do the roles and responsibilities look like? And so just that's kind of the theme that we've been hearing, and we're trying to address those as they come up.
And I would say, you know, seeing how this has gone from, you know, the three slides to now where you're at, you are addressing those concerns. So I think it's maturing very nicely.
Thank you. We're making a good faith effort.
Okay. So do you have what you're looking for then, based on that information? Okay. And so we have a consensus. There was at least three of us that said, yes, we want to task you with figuring out how to make sure we have adequate support for making sure for the supervision and evaluation piece. And again, that's about span of control. That's looking at good God in heaven. You're now responsible for holding accountable 14 people in high level positions versus six or seven. And that's a lot. It's a lot more than we ask any of our other zone leaders to do. And so we want to make sure that you all have enough of the right support and enough of the right feedback. And that's the purpose behind my question, at least. So
I will work with Mr. Anderson and Mr. Dorsey to respond to that concern. And I'll preview one of the ways that I'm going to frame it. Mr. Dorsey was already responsible for supervising and evaluating the entire three-page list. He had that focused through a single individual, but all of the factors, all of the functions were under his supervision. So we're talking about distributing those functions over a team versus an individual. That is more difficult, but the functions didn't multiply, the numbers of persons. And so I would invite all of us to question whether your job got easier or harder when the solo superintendent became what sits over here.
Some was harder and some was easier.
It's exactly.
Way easier to write one evaluation and have one set of evaluative meetings than it is to do a good job on three. There are certain aspects of being a more informed board member that help my decisions better by having the three of you. But in terms of being a good supervisor as a part-time unpaid volunteer, I think, and making sure we do justice to evaluations, that's harder with three of you because it's a heck of a lot. It's a lot more work, in my opinion, to do a good job on those three. Just one opinion, but I've done it both ways. So
fair take. And I think you guys do 3x what many boards do 1/4x. You know, you are more thorough with your evaluations of us than most boards are of their superintendent. So we will take it as a tasking. Mr. Anderson, Mr. Dorsey, and I will prepare perhaps not a presentation, because some of this maybe is not appropriate for public conversation, but we will bring to you a proposed management system so that we can manage the workload, still get the depth of evaluation that we've committed to as a district without burning Mr. Dorsey to a crisp.
Thank you, though.
The asbestos plan.
It's not about the person. It's about the position and the span of work. I just want you to know that's where it's coming from me. It's not, you know, there are people who I know who do great things who I've still looked at and said, but I'm not looking at the person.
And I think it's more informational to us, so we are doing our due diligence than we are voting and approving your plan, that plan of evaluations and stuff.
Okay, so then I think we're ready to move this. Oh, sorry, Donna, yes, question.
I'm sorry, just I want to clarify the timeline will be before the vote,
or no, that
what the timeline
after.
Is for this task, so that just so I have it in my minutes.
Yeah. And do you think August is fair for you to get back to us on that, given you'll be gone for a couple weeks now too?
It makes sense to me that you would want this before the school year starts. So, and that's why I'm sort of uncoupling it from your meeting agenda. So I think this would come to you probably in the second or third week of July, because these principals are leading as new teachers come on board and returning teachers come back the last week of July. So I would say nominally, think about the 23rd to 24th of July as a deliverable.
Okay, got it. Okay.
Well, I was just going to say, if we're going to move this as an action item, and I don't know if we are, but I would like to ask that it be put on the special meeting so that when they are hiring and looking at new teachers, they know what is happening before July meeting. Just would be my suggestion.
I was going to make the same comment. I think give them more runway to get off the ground.
Okay, I'm fine with that. So is everyone good? So we'll move this forward as an action item on the special.
Yep.
Thank you. And thank you for putting all that time in. And now we are on to the concurrent enrollment performance report.
Good evening, I'm Mary Perez, concurrent enrollment director. Tonight I'd like to give you a brief overview of our first year of concurrent enrollment. We did a pilot in the spring last year. I think you all remember we had about 50 students that started in concurrent enrollment. And in the fall of this year, we started with 181 students in concurrent enrollment across the district. That includes our AVP students, our homeschool students, also our Health Academy at Falcon High School, as well as a few Ascent students, about 12 Ascent students that stayed for an extended year. And from fall to spring, we grew that number about 25%. Those were students that typically had one class in the first semester and then added on another class, or also we had a few students that didn't meet our deadlines that were very frustrated with us because we were very strict with those deadlines, and so they really hustled to get their paperwork in and get processed into the program for the spring. We're really excited about the college credits that these students earned throughout the year, over 900 in the fall and over 1500 in the spring. The success rate, which is based on obtaining an A, B, or C in a college class, does not include these, was 92% in the fall. And although the slide does say 94%, we got some late information, performance information from our Health Academy because they were finishing up their clinicals a little late in the year, and that actually is 95%, which is significant to us because the state average is 93%, so we're 2% over the state average for concurrent enrollment. And that's something I think to be very proud of. I am anyway. I think all the schools are very proud of that. What else did I want to mention? The average number of credits per student in this first year was about 5 credits per student in the first semester and nearly 6.8 in the second semester. This is a graph that we put together showing post-secondary engagement with the same group of students doing concurrent enrollment with actuals in the fall and spring of this past year. And we wanted to project for you kind of conservative numbers of what concurrent enrollment and the number of credits earned might look like over the next 4 years. My guess is we're going to blow this graph out of the waters, but it's kind of hard to tell. We think that these numbers are conservative. We may have as many as 12 or 1300, maybe 1500 students doing concurrent enrollment over all of our high schools, our homeschool program, and now with the oncoming early college schools that we have that can extend concurrent enrollment into grades 12 plus 1 and 12 plus 2. So this is very exciting news.
Mary, I'm just going to interrupt quickly. Yes. Can you flip back to that slide for a second? Mm-hmm. In the current year, the value, the dollar value of those credits to students, and remember, this is not coming out of their pocket, is over $230,000. That's in the current year. So if you look at the size of the spring 16 bar and then extrapolate that out, that's almost, even conservatively figure, that's $200,000. You can see the real savings to district families growing and growing over time.
Just real quick, what about, because we're building a new one now, a
charter high school. What about charter schools? High school school current enrollment.
I'll look at Andy Franco. Is he still here?
I can speak from here to save Andy trotting across. Banning Lewis Prep Academy intends to have concurrent enrollment as part of their program. The Rocky Mountain Classical Academy High School homeschool program does not. So it's going to be varied by the population. Mm-hmm. We've already had that conversation with both of those entities. It's such a good deal for students who are capable of college level coursework that we want to make sure it's available. And it certainly will be available at Power Technical Early College, which is a charter school, but it will also be part of the BLPA program as they come online.
I've been working with PPEC as well as PTEC, but I have not started working with the other charter schools yet. And Goal Academy has their own support system for concurrent enrollment. Yeah. Okay.
Grow them more, even more then.
Correct.
So, okay.
Correct, because those numbers are not in there. Mm-hmm. We thought you might be interested in seeing what some of the typical classes are that a lot of our students take. And I've got the first four here with an asterisk showing the classes that are being taught on our high school campuses: English Composition 1, that's freshman English comp, as well as Introduction to Literature, are both being taught on all of our traditional high school campuses right now. And U.S. History and College Algebra, U.S. History is coming on in the spring, and College Algebra is currently being offered at Vista Ridge High School. A lot of our students start concurrent enrollment in English and literature to make sure they have that solid foundation so they can survive a U.S. history class that has a big college paper. Even psychology can be really tough for a student that hasn't survived English Comp 1. So psychology, American government is going to be key. A lot of students are looking to take that class because it will knock out a high school graduation requirement at the same time. Public speaking, a couple of science classes, and American Sign Language is very popular. On the CTE side, automotive technology, a lot of computer science classes are very popular, including CAD, criminal justice, and you can see the list. Diesel power welding is very popular. It's so popular that Pikes Peak Community College's program is maxed out, and they're looking for other partnerships to open up more classes for welding. Those students may or may not pursue the full degree. They may stack professional industrial certifications and get really good jobs after they complete those certifications. Adding capacity is something that we're always looking at. How do we add capacity for concurrent enrollment? Of course, the authorization of Power Technical Early College and Pikes Peak Early College is extending that concurrent enrollment early college opportunity at least a year or two. If students are not 21, we can extend it into grade level 12 plus 3. I don't know how many students want to stay in high school that long, but it could happen. The on-campus courses that are now mostly English, Comp 1, and Literature, as I said before, we're actually sending teachers back to graduate school through the next bullet, which is the college instructor prep program. And so we have a teacher at Vista that just finished her graduate work, and she'll be starting to teach the English and the literature next year. We have an authorized instructor out at Falcon High School. And I want to pause here for a minute and introduce a college professor who we hired as a district. He's also the coordinator of concurrent enrollment instruction, and this is probably one of the smartest hires we ever made, because we're building such a solid foundation in more than one way, and that's Paul Finch. Can you stand up, Paul? Paul Finch. I really appreciate working with him, and I can talk on behalf of the high schools as well. We have heard so many positive things about Paul Finch from both students, faculty, and parents. He's just a real pleasure to work with. He builds in soft skills development into his lectures. He gets to know these students, and they come back and take the next class, whether or not they need that arts and humanities or not, and most of them do. But it's been a real pleasure working with Paul Finch. Not only is he teaching our students how to become college students and handle the rigor and the pace and the expectations of a college setting, but he's also helping to teach parents how how to be college parents. And he's teaching our instructors how to switch gears from the high school pedagogy to teaching as a college professor. And sometimes that's difficult to do. It may not sound difficult to do, but it is a difficult switch to stop giving extra credit and to stick to your guns on deadlines and not want to give that extra 5 days, because that's what we do to help students succeed. But that does not set up students for success when they leave our campuses. So Paul is a real key part of the success of concurrent enrollment, and I just really appreciate him. We stole him from the community college before they had a chance to make him a job offer. So we're really happy that he's here.
And sorry to interrupt again, but this is so much of my heart. Mary and I have known about Paul by reputation for almost, well, it's been about seven years. Because at a school that we both used to work at, the students would come home and say, you gotta get Professor Finch. They'd come back and tell their friends. And you know, teenagers don't recommend a professor who doesn't care about them. And so it was a tremendous, tremendous opportunity to bring Paul online. And I appreciate the board's innovation in doing that and Mary's relationship and persistence, because it is giving us a competitive advantage that nobody else can have because they don't have Paul.
He's the silver bullet, yes. Mm-hmm. Another part of adding capacity is purchasing free college textbooks for our on-campus courses. And you may wonder how we did that. I actually talked to Brett last year before the school year began and said, if we have any money left over, any funding, any budget left over from the Ascent program, which was new money coming in for the fifth year students that were doing concurrent enrollment, may we spend those monies on those textbooks? And we did. We had a little bit of extra money, and so we're investing that back into the program so that those students that are starting on our high school campus don't have to purchase those textbooks. Paul is inventorying them through the library system, barcoding the textbooks, and managing them that way. So we're really excited to be able to provide that to our students. The Creekside Success Center, partnering with Pikes Peak Community College so that they can have those classrooms on the upstairs, offering some of those general ed classes, including the American Sign Language, which seems to be more and more popular, is coming on. And then, of course, the 49 Pathways Transportation Program that was just recently authorized. Gene Hammond was really fantastic in working with us to build some schedules so that not only did we have transportation to the Centennial Campus of Pikes Peak Community College, but also a bus shuttle that travels between our high school campuses. Okay. And the last slide is on looking ahead for new collaborations with UCCS. As you know, UCCS is a four-year institution of higher ed with tuition and fees. It's more than twice what Pikes Peak is. So we don't have a lot of students going there, but they're trying to get in the game. We appreciate that. However they slice it up so that maybe it can be a little more affordable to our families that want to go there. Pueblo Community College came up just last week and met with Paul and I, and we were amazed at the customer service attitude that they have. And they have programs in allied health and dental hygiene. They now offer a four-year degree in dental hygiene that our students can access, and we're not limited by service area agreements. CTE and concurrent enrollment pathway alignment, we're going to be working on with Nikki Lester to make sure that some of those career and tech ed classes that articulate college credit can feed into these pathways. And then, of course, with the new high school graduation guidelines, various ways of showing demonstration, mastery demonstrations, including capstone projects, internships. Of course, another way to show show mastery is through the cut scores by taking these ACCUPLACER exams. We have more and more students that are taking those exams, so that gives us an indication of what we need to do to better prepare them. And not only for those students that are passing college level classes, but those that are passing the prerequisite for those college classes, bring our remediation rate down to zero and show mastery demonstrations. So we're very excited. And next year we're looking at a 90% increase in enrollment, up to about 350 students starting in the fall. Are there any questions for myself or for Professor Finch?
The Do they have to take the Accuplacer test to take the courses that are offered in our high schools?
They do. Okay. Yes, they do. That's part of the process. Mm-hmm. And even for courses that don't require the Accuplacer, we have all students take the Accuplacer, so we have a benchmark and know where they're at and what we need to do to get them prepared. Some of the Associate of Applied Science degrees and welding and some of the vocational areas have Accuplacer scores that are lower than say college algebra and English Composition 1, so we still want to know where they're at.
Mm-hmm. 95% is outstanding, you know.
I should say so.
Yeah,
we've got some dynamite students.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Properly motivated kids, there's no telling what they're going. So thank you guys very much for giving that opportunity, really.
And they don't all pass on our campuses either. Professor Finch doesn't pass everyone. So he's a good guy, but they know he will fail them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes, but remember, they fail. You didn't fail them. They failed. There's
Correct.
A difference.
Correct.
It's the individual students' demonstration of knowledge that failed them, not an individual teacher who failed them.
So sometimes we create these odd configurations, and we have one with Mr. Finch. Professor Finch is working himself out of a job because right now he's teaching classes on our campuses, but he is also teaching our teachers to be college professors. So why is that still the right thing to do, Paul? Why is it right for us to develop teacher capacity when we already have this great, why shouldn't we just stay with you indefinitely?
Well, the relationship that the teachers already have at the high schools is paramount. So that's the first thing I would say. And secondarily, it creates a great relationship with us, with each of the schools. And there are a lot of great teachers at all of these schools that I've been around, and they're already doing a great job. And I've watched a number of the high school teachers teach, and I've already been saying, you can do this. You just need to go back and get that piece of paper or that certificate or what have you. So we already have a lot of great teachers who can do this. We don't need to bring adjuncts from Pikes Peak Community College. We have the teachers. So that would be my answer to that.
And the demand is going to outpace even Paul's ability to develop teachers. And so we're not at any risk of running out of student demand. We're more likely to get behind on the instructor level. And so we really appreciate what Paul has done, what you all have done in approving the Teach Back program, where we're funding the last, basically kind of the last semester that a teacher might need to get certified. This is a really powerful synergy. And it's because you were able to see the potential in it as a board and approve that creative position that is Paul and the creative funding approach that is our Teach Back teacher development program. Those two things together are really delivering for families in District 49.
Anyone else have any questions?
I'd just like to congratulate you. It's been fun watching this come together, and the collaboration and the leverage you guys are getting is amazing. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, and our final item, 9.06, election planning.
Brett Ridgeway, Chief Business Officer. Before I go on to this, I realized that I was remiss in the earlier presentation of not mentioning that Christiana Fogler is, of course, here, and she was part of the budget subcommittee as well. And we appreciated her participation in that. So I'm sorry. Matt will talk here in a minute about kind of his next steps on marketing plan and stuff, which we have some key things coming up over the next month or so. So the information I wanted to bring to you here in this presentation is focusing on priority two, which is one of the most valuable portions of this plan that we've been presenting. One other anecdote before I go into this is I did finish up all of the school, the district coordinated school staff presentations before the end of the year. And so that was a really great process and really garnered just a lot of support for what we have been proposing so far with this. So there was a lot of work being done over this last month to really put together the list of projects. But just to reorient you with what we were talking about here, again, in priority two, we wanted to address one of the most consistent feedbacks we've gotten in prior election cycles about why don't you take care of the buildings you have. And so having this portion of the proposal to have a 10-year cycle with a $20 million investment opportunity for all 22 buildings in the district is something that I've been really excited about as the way it's come together for this. And these were the kind of the general categories that we had suggested for this. Again, this was not about expanding any particular school. This is just about taking care of what's there and providing some funds to do that, either in terms of updating shorter lived assets or making some aesthetic and functional improvements to the buildings. This page here is a timeline. You see how short of a timeline it is, starting in April and ending in May. So just, you know, a little over 45 days or so, where there was work between Jack and Melissa from the central area here, working with each school and zone leaders to talk about what projects were going to be a good opportunity for them in terms of what they would like to see in priority two. This was refresh where we were at in terms of how the money had been allocated out to all the schools, basing on the size of the building, and then weighting that based on the age of the building, since this was our first iteration of this program. So what you'll see here then is 22 individual pages of the project list for each school page. You'll see the amount of funds that we calculated on that previous page that would be available in priority two. What you'll see on the coordinated school pages is, well, on every page, you'll see kind of a top list of what has been requested or recommended by the building leadership that they would like to see at the priority two. The bottom section is what the administration from Jack and Melissa's perspective were recommending to them. The little tick marks or the chevrons over here at the bottom indicate basically the level of consensus, the collaboration that kind of really came together between that discussion. And so a lot of pages, you see a lot of agreement and consensus in terms of what was identified and brought to the building leadership as needs from the facilities and the planning perspective, and then what they ultimately ended up selecting in that. So I didn't want to read all this obviously for you. But I think it's just, yeah, there's 175 projects on this list, give or take a couple, I think. So this is a lot of good stuff that can happen if we continue to pursue this and we're able to be successful with this idea. A lot of good work, a lot of good upgrades that will be able to be visible and visible quickly to our community, to our staff, to our students, in terms of these individual projects. So did you have any particular questions as you had reviewed this ahead of time on any particular school or anything?
I didn't have any on a particular school. I just wanted to kind of follow along our theme that we were talking about of putting a lot of work on an individual. So this is a lot of work on Jack. And are we going to be giving him support by project managers, or that's a lot of new projects?
Yeah, Sean's going to help me. So just to come out a little bit of that, we have had some preliminary discussions as far as how we would be able to do it, you know, whether it's working with third-party project managers, basically redeploying some internal staff as well that may be in a position to do that as well. But you know, and that's a little bit of the collaboration between planning and myself, as well as Director of Facility Ron Lee, a little bit how we're going to do that. It is a huge task. It's one that I really look forward to and hope we get the opportunity to do it. But we have talked a little bit about that as well.
There were a couple of schools, and I don't remember which ones, where, you know, and I see like secure entry and safety and security package are listed under district's recommendations for pretty much every single building. There were a couple of schools where I didn't see it on their prioritization. And I have a little bit of a concern about that, because from my perspective, that needs to be a standard across the district. If we know we have a school that has a less secure entry versus a more, part of the purpose of this is to make sure everybody has that same standard of safety. And this is way preliminary because, of course, until the voters approve something, we don't even have the money to work with. And so in the end, we'd be looking at those final projects aren't necessary. This isn't really a final list yet, but and I know some of those things may have also been covered by MLO. Like I said, I think some of the schools that already purchased pieces of the safety and security package with some of their MLO funds, but I'd like more information on that piece where the school didn't pick that. And then how we decide, you know, when there isn't consensus, where is the final decision? I'm assuming actually we are the final decision on the piece where there is not consensus. Me as an individual board member, I'm going to say the safety piece. I would not want to be the person standing in front of my community saying, well, we didn't invest in security in this building and we did in that one. And so from my perspective, I'd like you guys to think through that piece in terms of. And I know there were a couple of schools that I noticed as I went through it that didn't have it on their prioritization. And given that heightened awareness in our country and in our community, personally, that's important to me to make sure we have that same standard in all our buildings.
Okay, we will follow up on that. Yeah, I did notice that as well. And so we will follow up and give you some information on that.
I just want to make sure I understood. The top is what the school has prioritized, numbered one through whatever.
Correct.
Normally numbered, not all of them. Mm-hmm. And then the bottom is what you guys are recommending.
It was what was suggested to them, or the information that was brought to them to say, hey, these are observations.
What did the Chevron mean?
That means when there was there that was actually selected up in the top.
Gotcha. Thank you.
And just as a point of clarification, I was talking about it where it actually exists on both lists, because obviously, like, for example, Vista and Falcon High were built post some of those security concerns, so they already have a secure entry. So the secure entry wasn't even listed on the district recommendation because that was already taken into account when the school was built. I'm talking about where it exists as a district recommendation and it's not on the school's list. That was my only question as I went through it.
Okay. So if there's any other questions on these, then if there's not, I'll bring up the guy with hair.
So I just wanted to let you guys know that in the next week and a half, the pamphlet that we've had that has been in schools, this document that you're all familiar with, in a slightly modified form that'll be folded, will show up in every mailbox in the district to inform our larger community. It will also on that have an invitation to attend a community information night at the three largest high schools. We'll have those on Monday, July 10th at Falcon High School, Tuesday, July 11th at Vista Ridge, and Wednesday, July 12th at Sand Creek High School. So we welcome and encourage and hope to see large numbers of our community at those meetings. I am in the process of putting together the results of the poll that we've been hosting on d49.org. We just sent a follow-up email to all of our families yesterday to kind of get them back into that. I know it's an interesting time of year, but I'd like to see a little bit more in the way of participation with that. But the numbers that I have thus far are very favorable. Granted, those are our employees and our parents, people that are directly connected with what we're doing. So I would anticipate a higher level of support from that community than we might see from the larger community. So I am preparing that information. We'll give it to the chief officers and to you guys in the next week. And that was all I had.
I'm good. Anyone have any questions?
I'd just like to comment. I mean, I really hope we get our community support. You know, we're not asking for a tax increase. So I would hope to think we could get support from our community and encourage people to allow us to have this second mill levy override, because we did very well with the first.
Any other questions or comments? Thank you both. And with that, I would like a motion to adjourn.
I move to adjourn.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any discussion? Hearing none, a vote, please. Butcher?
I'm out the door.
Graham?
Aye.
Harold?
Aye.
Livia Wright?
Aye.
Moore?
Aye.
Motion carries. Meeting is adjourned at 8:58.